Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back. And we are back with a new webinar session, which is on GSTR2. We will be starting the session sharp at 2:30. That's in next 2 or 3 minutes. We welcome you back again and request you all to put all your queries and questions in the question and answer section, which is on the top. Or if you are joined as a attendee, it will be on the left. Thank you.
Technology in everyday life, understanding what Digital India program is, what are the vision areas of Digital India and its 9 pillars. Remember the days when we had to pen down letters and walked to the nearest post box to drop them? And now, the evolution over the years has enabled us to send messages and letters in less than a second. Let's go back to older times where we had rotary dialer phones. These phones were replaced by mobile phones. Our everyday lives have never been so easy. All thanks to the digital technology which helps in making calls, chatting, sending emails, looking up for information within seconds. Let us now see how people are using digital technology in their day-to-day life. Preeti uses the internet to interact with her friends and to take online lessons. She uses an UPI Pay app on her phone to buy movie tickets, order food, book a cab, and recharge her metro card. For her, life is
good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back, and we are ready to start our webinar on preparation and filing of GSTR2. We have our eminent speaker with us, Shri Rajiv Agrawal sir, who has been taking quite a few webinars, and we all are familiar with him. He is a SVP Outreach and Capability Building at GSTN, and BTech from IIT Kanpur. Not taking much of your time, I would be handing over the mic to sir. Before just handing over, a few ground rules and housekeeping rules. Refrain from asking questions in the chat box and put the questions in the question and answer section. This will help us in answering most of the questions and also reverting back to you if we are not able to take questions in the session. If few of your friends are not able to join the webinar, request you to direct them to our YouTube channel, which is Digital India Learning. And you can always find the presentation and the videos of all past, present, and future webinars on kms.nigt.in. Welcoming our speaker, Shri Rajiv Agrawal, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody. As introduced by Prabhakar, my name is Rajiv Agarwal. I am Indian Revenue Service Officer, and I am on deputation to GSTN, Goods and Services Taxes Network. And I welcome you on webinar today, webinar on filing of GST R2 return and something we will discuss about GST R2A. Before we begin, I would like to thank Mr. Shilau Rao, Prabhakar and NEGT team, which have made this platform available for us so that we can conduct the webinars and disseminate information regarding GST portal to you. Further, I would like to thank my GSTN team, which consists of Sri Jagmal Singh, Sri Bhagwan Patil, and Sri Pankaj Arora, who have helped me in understanding and fine-tuning my knowledge about GST R2 and GST R2A. Further, I would like to thank Mr. Rohit Mandal for making this PowerPoint presentation. I will thank Mr. Rajiv Kumar Sharma of the GSTN team, which has made all infrastructure facilities available for us. Then I will thank Mr. Anupam from PwC, who has made me acquainted with the portal and the GST R2 return. That will help us all. In following, in know about the GST R2 return. So the agenda for the current webinar is overview of GST R2A. Then we will go look into overview of GST R2. What are the instructions which is given by the department or Government of India to file GST R2? And then we will see a demo of GST R2 and 2A. And we will try to answer some other question and answer session. Our session will be around 60 to 65 minutes. We thank you for joining for this webinar. So the overview, the first we will take an overview of GST R2A. GST R2A is a system generated draft statement of inward supplies for a receiver taxpayer. So GST R2A is for a taxpayer who is receiving the goods or services as supplies from a supplier. So it's system generated and it's in a draft mode. So what means a draft mode? It means that it is available for view only, which we will cover later on. How is GST R2A is made? GST R2A is auto-populated from GST R1 and 5, GST R6, which is filed by input service distributor, GST R7, which is filed by tax deductor at source, and GST R8, which is filed by tax collector at source. So the suppliers who are filing GST R1, then non-resident foreign taxpayers who are filing GST R5, GST R6, 7, 8, when it is filed by the taxpayer, then the data from these flows into GST R2A and it is auto-populated over there. So even if the return 1, 5, etc. is not filed, it will still flow into the GST R2A and the receiver will be able to see it. So it is available for a given tax period. So if we are considering July, it will be available for the month of July. The details becomes available to the receiver taxpayer for view only. So when we are talking about 2A, we are talking only about 2A, and for 2A is only available for view. And details are updated incrementally as and when supplier taxpayer upload or change their details. So as and when the supplier taxpayers changes his details in 1, 5, 6, 7, or 8 GSTR, then the data is updated incrementally. As and when the changes are made, it gets populated into GST R2A. The auto-populated details of a particular supplier will get frozen when he submits or file his return. So any details which is submitted by the supplier taxpayer and he files his GST R1 or 5, then that gets frozen when he submits his return GSTR 2A of a taxpayer will remain available for view till a taxpayer submits files his GSTR 2A. So GSTR 2A is available and it is not frozen till GSTR 1, 5, etc. returns is filed by the supplier. And when it is actually submitted, then the details will not be any more populating in GSTR 2A. But when the supplier receiver taxpayer submits his GSTR 2, then GSTR 2A gets frozen. And then no changes in GSTR 2A happens thereafter. So further continuing with the overview of GSTR 2A, when the counterparty has not submitted file his GSTR 1A, so we are considering two conditions, when the counterparty has not submitted his GSTR 1 and when the counterparty has submitted file his return. So we consider the first part, when the counterparty has not submitted his GSTR 1, then any and all invoices uploaded by supplier taxpayer in GSTR 2 will be visible in GSTR 2A, and the same can also be viewed in the GSTR 2 of the recipient. So any invoices which is uploaded by the supplier taxpayer and has been filled in GSTR 1 and has been saved by him will be visible in GSTR 2A of the recipient, and he can view it in GSTR 2A as well as GSTR 2. When the counterparty has submitted his return, so the supplier has submitted his return, like return 1, 5 or 7 or 8, he has submitted his return, then the invoices will be available in GSTR 2A for viewing. Addition to that, receiver taxpayer will be able to take action on the invoices which is submitted by the supplier. His accept or reject button will be enabled. So he can use accept or reject button, and using that button, he can take action. The information available in GSTR 2A will also be available in GSTR 2, and the action will be taken by him will not be in GSTR 2A, but will be action will be taken in GSTR 2. So taxpayer is not required to file GSTR 2A. It is a read-only document provided, so the taxpayer can have a record of all the invoices received from various supplier taxpayer in a given tax period. So what is the crux of the 2A is that it gets auto-populated. Whenever the supplier is uploading his return, then the invoices gets visible in GSTR 2A. No action can be taken in GSTR 2A. When the invoices are all the returns, supposing all the returns by all my suppliers are filled in, then there is going to be no changes in GSTR 2A. Obviously, because GSTR 2A gets populated from GSTR 1, 7, 8, etc. kind of return. Further, when I submit my GSTR 2, then my GSTR 2A gets frozen. So no changes in GSTR 2A can happen. But as and when it is saved by my supplier, I can view it in my GSTR 2A. No action can be taken in GSTR 2A. Action has to be taken in GSTR 2. And when my supplier submits his GSTR, his relevant GSTR, then I can take an accept. Any accept and reject button is initiated and I can take action on it. Now, further continuing with the overview of GSTR 2A. GSTR 2A for a given period will be available for viewing and or downloading in taxpayers post login section of the GST portal. So if there is a GSTR 2A, I can actually view it online and I can download it also. But this will happen after post login. So I have to log in into the system with my username and password. And after that, I can view it and I can download it as well. Taxpayer cannot make any changes in GSTR 2A, as we have already learned. It's only a read-only document. The information displayed in GSTR 2A is also available in GSTR 2, and all action has to be taken in GSTR 2 by the receiver. When GSTR 1 is filed after filing of GSTR 2 by the counterparties, the details declared in GSTR 2 gets auto-populated to GSTR 1A of the supplier, and the supplier is expected to take action on such details before filing his GSTR 3 return. So supposing GSTR 1 return is filed and I am filing my GSTR 2 return, I am a receiver and I have added some details. What happens to those details? Those details gets auto-populated to GSTR 1A of the supplier. And when supplier is filing his GSTR 3 returns, then he has to make accept or reject or keep it pending for action before he actually files his GSTR 3. So an alert in the form of email and message on the dashboard will be sent to the taxpayer when any new details are auto-populated into GSTR2A. So as and when my GSTR2A is updated, an email and a message is sent on my dashboard. So taxpayer is alerted that a new addition has taken place or a modification has taken place in his GSTR2A. So if he wishes, he can go and view the invoices uploaded by his supplier. Now, there are four parts of GSTR2A, part A, B, and C. Part A consists of three tables, right? And these tables come from GSTR1 and GSTR5. So GSTR1 is filed by the supplier and GSTR5 is filed by non-resident taxable person. So whatever is the information given by supplier and taxable person in GSTR5, it goes into table 3, table 4 and table 5 of part A of GSTR2A return. What does table 3 is? Table 3 consists of business to business supply details. Table 4 consists of debit and credit note details. And table 5 consists of amendment to credit and debit notes, which has been filed earlier. So these details gets into part A of the GSTR2A on the basis of the return filed by GSTR1 and GSTR5. Now, if there is a return, which is GSTR6 return, which is filed by input service distributor, then that goes into part B of the GSTR2A and it goes into table 6. And details on account of eligible ITC and ineligible ITC is shown over here. And thus, it is auto-populated. So as we know, there is no entry in GSTR2A. Every details are auto-populated by one method or other. What we have covered is part A, that is table 3, 4, and 5, which is auto-populated from the GSTR 1 and 5. Then part B, which is auto-populated from ISD return, GSTR 6 return in table 6. Then part C. Part C table has two parts, that is table 7A and table 7B. Table 7A gets populated from GSTR 7 return, which is filed by TDS deductors, tax deductor at source. Whenever they file their GSTR 7 returns, the details are reflected in part C of GSTR 2A, which is table 7A. And whenever tax collected at source is filed by the tax collector at source, that is GSTR 8, then that detail is filled in part C of the GSTR 2A, table 7B. So these are auto-populated on the basis of GSTR 1, 5, 6, 7, and 8 returns. But the uniqueness is that for table 3, 4, and 5, the taxpayer, the receiver taxpayer can amend it, he can modify it. But for the details which is pre-populated from GSTR 6, filed by ISD, GSTR 7 filed by TDS, or GSTR 8 return filed by TCS, then that can either be accepted or rejected. So he cannot modify anything over here. Part B, Part C cannot be modified. It can either be accepted or it can either be rejected only. So that's the point to be noted. So that's the part of the GSTR 2A. We will see the live demo later on. What we will do is that now we will move into the GSTR2. So what we have learned so far is that the details gets auto-populated into GSTR2A and GSTR2 both, whatever details are uploaded by the supplier. But action could only be taken in GSTR2. No action can be taken in GSTR2A. It's auto-populated and it's available for view only. Now we will understand the salient features of GSTR2. Now, GSTR2 is a return which is to be filed by a receiver taxpayer. So receiver taxpayer has to actively file his GSTR2 returns. So receiver taxpayers are required to file GSTR2 returns. It's a statement of inward supplies. Like whatever supplies I have received as a receiver, I have to give those details in GSTR2 returns. The details are to be given on monthly basis. And if there are any population of the details, as we have seen, like it comes from GSTR 1, 5, 7, 6, and 7 and 8, then the receiver can either accept it, it can modify it, it can reject it, or it can keep it pending. So whatever details are invoice level data is given by my receiver, given by my receiver supplier, I can accept, modify, reject, or keep it pending. So as we have seen, for the supplies which are received from ISD, TCS or TDS, I can either accept or reject only. But for rest, I can do modify and keep it pending also. So on the basis of the details which are auto-populated, I will accept, modify, reject, or keep it pending depending upon whether supplies have been received or not. Apart from this four action, the receiver taxpayer can also add invert supplies. So if there is a supply which has been received and which has not been uploaded by the supplier taxpayer, that can be added by the receiver taxpayer by adding invoices in his GSTR2. So some supplies not added by the supplier. Point is that GSTR2 needs to be filed even if there is no business activity during a given tax period. So if during a given tax period there is no business activity, still nil return is to be filed by the receiver taxpayer. So the receiver taxpayer will have to file a nil return. Now, who are the persons who are required to file GSTR2? And the corollary question comes, who are not required to file GSTR2? So whoever are liable to file GSTR1 return is liable to file GSTR2 return, and they are also liable to file GSTR3 return. Then who are the persons who are not able to who are not liable to file GSTR1 return? So it's provided under the law that taxpayers under the composition scheme, non-resident foreign taxpayer, input service distributor, tax deductor at source, and TCS, like tax collector at source, are not required to file GSTR1, and hence they are also not required to file GSTR2 returns. So what is GSTR2? It's the details of the invert supplies. All invert supplies of goods and or services are to be mentioned in GSTR2. It also includes supplies of services on which tax is payable on the reverse charge basis. So if there is any supply on which tax is payable under reverse charge basis, that is also to be shown here. And it also includes details of interstate invert supplies, debit note or credit notes, and supplementary invoices issued during a specific tax period. It contains details of the advances also. So if any advances are to be adjusted, or that is also to be shown in GSTR2. So these are the information which has to be given in GSTR2 by the receiver taxpayer. Now we will see what are the due dates to file GSTR2. Normal taxpayers, GSTR current tax period. So basically, if I'm in the month of July, the facility has been given for me, if I'm a supplier, I can upload my GSTR1 return, the details of the invoices in my GSTR1 return. But for the normal taxpayer, the GSTR2 cannot be acted upon until the current tax period is over. So for July, up to 31st July, I cannot take any action. I cannot take any action even up to 10th of the July, 10th of August, because July return, if we are talking about the January return. So if we are talking about January, I cannot file my GSTR2 in the month of January. I cannot even file it during up to 10th of February. I can only file it between 11th to 15th of the February. So that's the period on which I can file my GSTR2 return. I can file thereafter also, but I will have to pay some late fees for it. Then there are two exemptions to it. So normal taxpayers are required to file their GSTR2 return after 11th of the month, and 11th to 15th is the window in which GSTR2 statement can be filed without any payment of penalty or fees, but thereafter it is to be done with the payment of fees. But there are two exceptions to it. One is the casual dealer, which are given their registration for a certain period of the time. So they can file as and when their business gets over. And the taxpayers who have applied for voluntary cancellation of GST registration, they can also file GSTR2 before the end of the current tax period if they have already received the cancellation order. So they have filed for the cancellation of the registration and they have received the cancellation order, they can file their GSTR2 return. So normal taxpayers will file between 11 to 15, and these are the two exceptions which can file anytime during the month. So we have already covered the example for January. I have to file January period GSTR2. I have to file between 11 to 15. But as of now, for the month of July 2017, yesterday the government has issued a notification and the date of filing GST R2 return for the July 2017 is made 11th to 25th of September 2017. File from 11th to 25th of the September 2017. So that's the notification number 29/17 by which this amendment, this change has been done. Earlier, this was to be filed between 5th to 10th of the September, and that's why we kept this webinar today. But now the date has been extended yesterday from 11th to 25th. GSTR2 has to be filed for the month of July. Now, if I am filing my GSTR2 return after due date, so supposing January is considered my due date is 11th to 15th, and if I file my GSTR2 after that, then there is certain late fees which has to be paid. So late fee will be charged after the due date, and it is auto calculated by the system. The payment is not to be done before filing of GSTR2. So if I am filing my GSTR2, it is not needed that I first make the payment and then I file my GSTR2. That is not required, but the fee must be paid before filing of GSTR3. But all the fees which is auto calculated and shown into my liability has to be paid before that. The fee must be paid before filing of GSTR3, but not before GSTR2. If there is late filing, it will be auto calculated and it will be shown into my liability registers. The charges for late filing of GSTR2 is Indian rupees 100 per day per act, which is 100 rupees will be CGST Act and 100 rupees will be SGST Act, and total will be 200 rupees. There is no liability from IGST Act on this account on the taxpayer. So 200 rupees per day is the liability which will be auto calculated and is to be paid before filing of GSTR3 returns. And late filing is after filing of the due date for the month of January. We consider it is will be 16 February onward. And for the month of July 2017, it will be 26 September 2017 onwards. Now, what are the details which are to be given? We have briefly covered that. So this slide gives you that in detail, what are the information which is covered in GSTR2. So some of the things which we have not covered will be covered. First is inward supplies received from an unregistered supplier, then import of services, then input capital goods received from overseas or SEZ units is to be given over here, then ISD credit, TDS, TCS credit, then HSN-wise summary details has to be given in GSTR2. So these are the information which is to be given in GSTR2 return. Then what we should note that, which is like, you know, kind of passing thing, we should be aware of it, that ITC can be claimed up to 12 months from the date on which original invoice was issued or annual return is filed, whichever is earlier. And there will be no transfer in the electronic credit ledger in case there is a gap of more than 1 year between the original invoice and date of filing of GSTR3 for the tax period when such details were uploaded. So these are the things we should be aware of, so that, you know, we are able to upload our invoices on time and we are able to take credit. See, if I'm a receiver taxpayer, then I should add invoices so that I can claim credit for it. Then what are the preconditions for filing GSTR2? So these are the normal things which is required. The receiver taxpayer should have a registered normal dealer and should have an active GSTIN. His GSTIN should be in active state. He should have a valid login credentials, that is username and password. He should have a valid and non-expired unrevoked digital signature certificate. Like for companies, it is mandatory that the form statement has to be signed digitally and then uploaded. So he should have a non-expired and unrevoked DSC. In case of others, EVC should be there. The mobile number should be available on which the verification code will go, OTP will go. Then due date for filing of GSTR1 for the same tax period should have elapsed. So the due date for filing normally is the 10th of the next month. For January, it will be 10th of February. And for July 2017, it is 10th of September 2017 as per the revised date given by the government. Then how to do it? The receiver logs into the GST portal using his login and ID and password. Then he navigates to services, returns and returns dashboard menu. Then he selects the financial year and the tax period for which he has to file a GSTR2 return, and he clicks search. Then all returns pertaining to that particular tax period will be displayed in different tiles. Then he selects GSTR2 tile, and then he clicks prepare online or prepare offline. Accordingly, he can prepare it. So what we will see in demo will be prepare online demo, and that there is a heavy demand for it, and we are going to show you soon. Then in the viewing mode, how we can view my GSTR2, it can be done in the post login mode. It's the same. It has to be gone into services menu, then returns, and return can view my GSTR2 return. So that's the steps to file GSTR2. The previous slides talks about the condition which is required to file GSTR2, and this slide talks about how we go through to file my GSTR2 return. Then what are the actions to be taken by receiver in GSTR2? Receiver taxpayer will be able to see the supplier wise summary of all invoices received. Against each invoice of each supplier, receiver taxpayer shall take one of the four possible action: accept, modify, reject, or keep it pending. Or he can add the missing invoice also. So if supplier has forgotten any invoices, that invoices can be uploaded by the receiver taxpayer. What happens after that? After taking action and entering, uploading all the invoices and details in the various section of GSTR2, taxpayer will click submit to validate the data. So what he has to do, which is not mentioned over here, is that generate summary of GSTR2. That is very important. What does generate summary of GSTR2 return does? Generate summary of GSTR2 returns. If there is information which has been uploaded by me and that information is not updated, so by clicking on generate summary, the information which is not updated will come back and it will update all my tiles, and that information will be available for us, and it takes a minute or two to validate to get all that data. Second, what validate summary does is that if there is any invoice which has not been updated in my tiles so far, but it has been uploaded by my supplier, my system will go back and will fetch those invoices, and it will upload those invoices in the relevant section. So if there is an invoice which has been missed by the receiver has not updated it so far, and just now I am filing my GSTR2 return, and my supplier has just now uploaded his GSTR1 return maybe in the morning, and it has not been populated into my GSTR2. By clicking on view generate summary, what will happen is that that invoice will come into my system and it will be available for me for taking action. So before you do a submit button, what you have to do is that you click on that button. After that, what you have to do is that you have to check on the declaration and click on submit button. But you must remember, if you click on submit button, no changes can be made. But before you click on submit button, there will be a preview which will be available. You can click on preview and download that GSTR2 return, and you can view it. And as you are aware, you have to save the data every time. Whenever you fill in any data, you have to save it so that that data gets populated into GSTR2 return. So what we are doing is that what we will do is that after data has been filled in, we can generate summary of GSTR2. Then I will click on the checkbox. Then I will click on submit button. After submitting, I cannot make any changes, but I can preview it because preview button is there. Then again, I will have to submit a declaration. And after that, I can submit the data using EVC or DSC. So I will file my GSTR2 now. If it is filed between 11 to 15 in a usual tax period, then no fee is payable. After that, 200 rupees fee is payable, as we have already seen. Now, what happens after that? A confirmation message will come for you to confirm or cancel the filing of GSTR2 return. You can say yes, and you can file your GSTR2 return. And an acknowledgement reference number, application reference number will be generated. So whenever you have submit any document in GST portal, ARN number, application reference number is generated, and that is available for you so that you can use it to tracking it further. So an SMS and email will be sent to the taxpayer on successful submission of the GSTR2. And once the return is submitted by the taxpayer, then the same return is available to the jurisdictional authority for viewing, and he can take any further action if he so wishes. And in case of amendments or additions, the details of counterparty supplier taxpayers are auto-populated in GSTR1A. So what happens when I submit my, I file my GSTR2 return? So I get a confirmation message, I get an ARN number, then an SMS and email is received by me, that return, that data will flow in auto flow into the GSTR1A of my supplier so that he can take, accept or reject the action which happens after filing of my GSTR2 statement. Then further details of the GSTR2 is that taxpayer will be eligible to avail the credit on reverse charge and expected to add validate on GSTR filing of GSTR2. So by filing of GSTR2, I either add invoices or I validate invoices that the whatever supplier has uploaded, I accept that yes, those are the supplies, those are the details which has been received by me. And if something is missing, I add those invoices. So I am validating my data. Yes, these are the supplies which have been received by me. Then current period ITC, what happens to the ITC? Current period ITC will be available for utilization for that tax period only. So I cannot utilize that current period tax ITC for making any other dues. But after a mismatch report is created, provisional ITC will be segregated to matched ITC and not matched ITC. Then matched ITC will be available for me for making other return related liabilities also. So till mismatch report is generated, my current ITC is available for utilization for tax related liabilities for that period only. After mismatch report is generated, my credit gets bifurcated into two parts, matched ITC and mismatched ITC. Matched ITC can be used for other return related liability payments also. And if receiver taxpayer is filing GSTR2 post filing of GSTR1 by the supplier, then he has to mandatorily take action on the information so received in GSTR2. So GSTR1 has been filed and the receiver has uploaded his GSTR2, supplier has uploaded his invoices in GSTR1. So if I am filing my GSTR2, I have to take actions on all those invoices first, or I can keep it pending and only then I can file my GSTR2 return. Then taxpayer cannot, which are available in his GSTR2. So if there is any details which has been uploaded by my supplier and that is available for me, then I cannot add those details. If I'm uploading some details which is already there and pre-populated because my supplier has uploaded it and I'm adding those details and trying to upload my GSTR2, system will show an error. So I have to first work on the invoices which I received through my supplier, and then I have to add other details. Whatever is already there, I cannot add it any further. So these are the finer points we should be aware of. And all accepted and modified invoices will become part of GSTR2 once uploaded by the supplier and accepted by the receiver. No changes thereafter could be made. And except while filing my GSTR2 return or whatever I modify, that becomes part of my GSTR2 for that tax period. Invoices which are kept pending will be rolled over to the next tax period. So I can keep it those invoices pending, because supposing on 31st July some goods have started and I have not received it on say 1st of August, I can at least keep it on pending. I can roll it over for the next month and can take action on those invoices later on. Then receiver can add any invoice, credit note, debit notes which are omitted by the supplier. This we have already seen. And in respect of amended business to business supply, TDS details, TCS details, receiver has to take action. He has to keep either keep it pending. So the receiver in his GSTR2 as we have seen, will auto-populate to GSTR 1A of the supplier in the same tax period if the supplier has not filed his GSTR 3, and supplier is expected to take action on those details. Either he has to accept it or he has to reject it. So if it is accepted, then the thread is closed. If it is rejected, then again the thread is closed and it goes into a mismatch report. So these are the whole schema of GSTR 2. Then supposing if GSTR 1 has not been filed by my supplier till the 10th, then GSTR 2 is filed by receiver before filing of GSTR 1. Then all B2B, amended B2B debit and credit note, amended debit and credit note details from GSTR 2 of the receiver will be auto-populated in the GSTR 1 of the supplier, and supplier has to take action. This point we have already covered. Receiver has to declare the details of services received where payment to the supplier is not made within 6 months from the date of received invoice on the ITC which has been claimed. So if I have claimed any ITC but I have not made any payment within 6 months, then I have to declare that details in GSTR 2. In such case, output tax liability will be created to the extent of ITC claimed earlier, and on such invoices along with the interest, and the GSTR 3 and tax liability ledger of the receiver will get updated. This directly flows from the law. It has been provided in the law that I should make payments within 6 months. If I don't make payments, then I am liable to pay the amount along with interest. So accordingly, tax liability ledger will be updated. In case of reverse charge supplies from unregistered person, receiver will issue invoice. I have to issue my own invoice, and same has to be reported in table 4A of the GSTR 2. And amendment of accepted invoice is not allowed. No amendment can be made of the accepted invoice. Any addition of new invoices, amendment of earlier invoices, debit credit note, and amendments in related invoices pertaining to a particular financial year shall not be allowed after filing of GSTR 3 of September next financial year, or GSTR 9, which is the annual return of the next financial year, whichever is earlier. So no addition, no amendments of credit debit notes, no amendment related to invoices is allowed of a particular financial year if I have filed return GSTR 3 returns of the next financial year, GSTR 3 of September next financial year, or annual return GSTR 9 of the current financial year. So if I file these two returns, either of the two returns, whichever is earlier, no amendment can be made in the previous financial year. In cases where taxpayers have converted from normal taxpayer to compounding taxpayer, then he entries in GSTR 2 filed after the date of conversion can be made only for invoices, documents date prior to the date of conversion. So if I'm supposing on 15th of September, I have converted myself from normal to compounding taxpayer, then I carry up to 15th of September. So prior to the date of conversion, I can make entries, but after the date of conversion, I cannot make any entries. Further rectifications will be allowed only in respect of original invoices, documents issued prior to the date of conversion. So if there is any rectification to the invoices which I have already issued, that can also be done by me if I am converting from my normal taxpayer to compounding taxpayer. Supposing I have cancelled or surrendered my GSTIN, then I can still file my GSTR 2 for the period on which I was active. If you remember whatever we had talked about prerequisites for filing GSTR 2, one of the condition was that I should be active. So if I have cancelled my registration for the period I was active, I can file my GSTR 2 return. Then any invoice, debit, credit note, date should be prior to the effective date of surrender or cancellation. So I cannot have any debit or credit note after the date of cancellation, effective date of surrender or cancellation. So supposing I am not filing my GSTR 1, 2, 3, what happens? Department can issue me a notice in the form of GSTR 3A. Then we will briefly go over the instructions to file GSTR 2A returns. So these are the things like POS refers to place of supply, B2B refers to supplies from one registered taxable person to another registered taxable person, P2 refers to from registered taxable person to unregistered taxable person, we normally say that it is from business to consumers. So in table 3-4 captures, as we have seen, invoice level inward supply of information, that is rate wise, and it is reported by the supplier in GSTR 1, and it is made available in GSTR 2 through auto population. Table 3 captures inward supplies other than those attracting reverse charge, because reverse charge supplies goes into table 4. The receiver taxpayer, which we have already seen, has four options: accept, reject, modify, or keep it pending. After taking the action, recipient taxpayer will have to mention whether he is eligible to avail credit or not. And if he is eligible to avail credit, then the amount of eligible credit against the tax invoice has to be mentioned. So this is one of the addition. If I am a recipient taxpayer, I am filing GSTR 2, I have to say whether I am eligible to avail credit or not, and how much is the amount which I am eligible for the credit. So we are talking about table 3 and 4, and this thing is also about table 3 and 4. The recipient taxpayers can add invoices. Table 4A will be auto-populated. We will see the details later on. In case of invoice added by the recipient taxpayer, place of supply to be captured is different from the location of the recipient. Then what is to be done is that we have to give place of supply so that eligibility of my credit is determined. So if I am receiving it from the registered person, then anyway, registered person is supplying, his GSTIN number is available in system. So anyway, I will know about it. So, but if there is any information which is supply coming from non-registered person, I have to give place of supply so that eligibility of the credit could be determined. Then recipient will have the option to accept invoices auto-populated as well as aid invoices pertaining to reverse charge only when the time of supply arises in terms of section 12 or 13 of the Act. So I have to read section 12 and section 13 carefully, and we have to see whether that my liability to pay my time of supply comes in within that tax period or not. So if I'm talking about January, my liability to pay under reverse charge as per section 12 or 13, time of supply should come in the month of January. Only then I have to give this detail in table 4. Recipient taxpayer is required to declare in column number 12 whether the inward supplies are inputs or input services or capital goods. So that is also to be distinguished, that whatever invoice on which I am taking credit is input or input service or capital goods. Then in table 5, I have to give details of the imports of goods or capital goods from outside. And if I've received any supplies from SEZ unit also, that is to be reported in table 5, and the details has to be given rate wise. Then recipient has to provide, in addition to above, bill of entry information, including port code and 7-digit bill of entry number has also to be given. Then taxable value in table 5 means assessable value for customs purposes, which is IGST, on which IGST is computed. So the value becomes the value which are declared to customs plus basic custom duties and other duties which is levyable on it. So if I have imported something and I have declared my value to customs as 100 rupees and my taxes basic custom duty comes as 110 rupees, then my assessor value for custom purposes is 100, and the value which I have to declare over here is 110, because my IGST is calculated on 110. So in case of imports, the GSTIN would be which is to be given will be the GSTIN of the recipient taxpayer. Then table 6 captures the information of amendments, and the information has to be given rate wise, which has been provided in table 3, 4, or 5. So whatever information has been provided in table 3, 4, or 5 and it is being amended, then that information has to be given in table 6. Table 7 captures information at a gross value level. So we have to give values in at the level of gross. Then in table 8, an option has been given similar to table 3, but it's slightly different. What we do in table 8, it is talking about ISD credit. Then what we have to do is that we have to redetermine the eligibility as well as the amount eligible as ITC. So in table 8, there is slight difference. We have to redetermine the eligibility also, and we have to redetermine the amount also. That is what we do in table 8. Then TDS and TCS credit will be auto-populated in table 9. And sales return and net volume columns are not applicable in case of TDS in table 9. So if there is any sales return and net value columns, which is there and available for and applicable for TCS, and it is not applicable for TDS, that is what the second line speaks about. Then in instruction number 10 says that the eligible credit from table 3, 4 and 8 pertaining to invoice supplies to be populated in electronic credit ledger on submission of its return in form GSTR3. So the eligible credit from table 3, 4 and 8 will be populated in electronic credit ledger on submission of the return in form GSTR3. Then recipient can claim less ITC on invoice depending upon the use. That's why the column is given what is the total credit which is there and what is the eligible credit. Information of advance paid pertaining to reverse charge supplies and the tax paid on it, including adjustment has against invoices issued, should be reported in table 10. Table 12 captures additional liability due to mismatch as well as reduction in output liability due to rectification of mismatch on account of filing of GSTR3 of the immediately taxable preceding taxable period. HSN has to be reported as it is to be reported in GSTR1. So if you are below your clearances are below 1.5 crores, then you need not give any HSN. Then we should particularly see table 11 because that's where the details of credit has to be given, which is to be reversed. So I will just go through a few of them. Like if we see 37.2, rule 37.2 talks about reversal of input tax credit on account of non-payment of consideration of supply by the recipient within the prescribed time limit. And as you are aware, the time limit is 6 months. I have not paid my amount within 6 months of the receipt. Then I have to show my reversal and I have to mention the details over here. Then if you see 42.1, it talks about reversal of credit attributable towards exempt supplies and for non-business purposes. 43.1H talks about capital goods used in exempted supplies. So these are all my reductions, but there are certain additions also, which is second last point on account of amount paid subsequent to reversal of ITC will reduce the my liability. So that's an addition which I get. So this is table which has to be carefully filled in. It is going to reduce my liability in certain cases, and it is going to increase my liability in certain cases. So if I have from my input tax credit, if it is not available, I have to deposit money in my account, bank account, and then I have to fill it. So this is the usual diagram which you have already seen. So that's about GSTR 1 and 2. Now is that we will start our we will see the details in demonstration. So before we start demonstration, what you should do is that you click on Control, Shift and Del. See if you are seeing in the screen, a new screen has opened up. So how I have come to this screen is, so just a second, we will just share this relevant screen. So sorry for the delay. I hope you're getting the screen now. So this is the screen which I wanted to show you, right? It's appearing. So how I have reached over here is that whenever you are working on GST portal and you are starting a session, you must do this. This is the recommended action. You must take this action. What I've done is that I have clicked on Control, Shift and delete. Remember, it is not Control Alt Delete. Just joking. It's Control Shift Delete. And after clicking, this thing opens up. Now, what I'm going to do is that I will clear my browsing history. If you can see, it's clearing my all browsing history. This is a must action. Why this is to be done? So that I am able to file my return. I am able to work this. The system takes some data from cache and it shows some mismatch and it shows throws up error. So I must do it. Then there is another method of going over there. And people must be aware of it. If you see, I am opening a new tab over here. So here, if you see, there is a history on that. Again, I have reached that page. So I clear browsing history over here. Then the same thing comes and I am clearing my browsing history. So this is very important. We must do that. That is Control Shift Del, pressed at the same time to clear up the history. Now I am going to log in into one of my systems which is available for us and will show you some activities. I'll do it for 15 minutes because it's already 3:25 p.m. But some details will be shown by me. And I'm opening up the portal. I will log in into it. So I'm filling my username, then I'm giving my password, and I'm entering my character, which is shown over here. Then it's asking me whether I want to save it or not. I will not save it. Then create challan is appearing, return dashboard is appearing, and view notice and orders is appearing for me. Then there is a services menu also. I can go through services menu also to the return dashboard over here, or I can use this icon return dashboard and I can go over there. So I will click on return dashboard. So as we have seen in one of the slides, the financial years opens up and return filing period September is opening. So we are in the month of September. And if you see, September has opened up for me. And I'm going to return dashboard. Why September has opened up is that because using this, I can upload my invoices, whatever clearances July, and click on search. Then my tiles are coming up. So if you see, there are various tiles, GSTR1 tiles, GSTR1A tiles, GSTR2A tiles, and GSTR2A tiles. So GSTR2A tiles is available for view and download. On clicking GSTR2A tile, I clicked on view. Then my if there is amendment, I can see it over here. So this. And TCS credit is part D of the table. Actually, in the form, it is part C of the table itself, and it is 7B. TDS credit is 7A. So right now, these tables are not enabled. We will just click on B2B invoices to see the details. So the details comes. So whoever supplier has made the supplies, I can view the details. His GSTI number is appearing. I can click on back and go back. I can click on the supplier number, and that PCA2 is that I will just see one of the invoices and click on that and see these invoices are available. I can see the item details, taxable values, etc. These are uploaded by the sub can see in the B2B invoices. As we are aware, we cannot take any action on there. Anything is available. So the message is coming, no invoices found for the provided inputs. So we'll just see anything is there in amendment to B2B invoices. So that tile is not enabled as of now. So nothing is coming. So that's about GSTR 2A, which is available for view. When I click the back button, I've gone back to the same details. What we will do is that we'll go for the month of July, and now we will see the GSTR2 returns. So GSTR2 returns, two options are available: prepare online and prepare offline. So an offline utility will be provided soon, and that could be used by the taxpayer to fill in their details of GSTR2. So I will click on prepare online button. On July, that details have come up. So various details are available. What you must see is one of the button which is appearing over here. If you can see refresh, what is this button refresh does? This refresh button does is that if there is invoices which has been uploaded by me, and if there are two invoices, I have gone inside and uploaded some of the invoices and it is not appearing, I can click on refresh button and I can get those details uploaded over here. So system will click here. So that's what the refresh button does. So refresh button actually refreshes the information which is already available on my dashboard. Then one of the important button is generate GSTR2 summary. So that's what we were talking about. What generate GSTR2 summary does is that if any information has been uploaded by me and you know it is not refreshed, then this information will get uploaded. Further, it will also fetch any other information which is not appearing in any of these tiles, but it has been uploaded by my supplier. So generate GSTR2 summary actually fetches those information and populates this table and makes those information available to me. But I will click on generate GSTR, changes are there. So if you just see, there are 11 in here, 411 invoices over here. We'll try our luck and see if anything is there in generate GSTR2 summary. And if you see, just generate GSTR2 summary process is initiated and it is saying that please recheck after 1 minute. So it will take some time. So it not only fetches the information which I have uploaded, it also fetches the information which has been uploaded by my supplier. So I can get both the information over here. So pending the information is being fetched, what we will do is that we will see straight away go and see the column number 11. If you remember, this is what we talked about. These are the reversal which will happen because of the credit used for some other purposes rather than providing the output supplies. Then if there is any other liability which is also to be mentioned over here, and if you notice, I cannot enter any details over here. Why? Because I have to click on a button which is edit button over here. Now I will enter some values over here for demonstration purpose. 5,000 rupees as integrated tax, 200 rupees as central tax, and 2,000 rupees as my 200 rupees as my state tax. Then if I don't save it, then this information will not be populated. What I will do is that save button. So if you see, my previous information was 5,000 integrated tax, 50 crores of central tax, and 5 lakh of state tax. This is what we have entered for demo testing the system, and so we have entered the W values. I will amend it, and it is there. So this information is there, and see whether that information is 55 lakhs. I think it has been edited. Earlier it was. Now this is correctly shown. So I will just make one more amendment and see it is coming or not. Then I click on save. Then I will see it is, system is still trying to save the information. It is taking some time. This is our testing software. So GSTR2 is to be released. There are rest of the functionalities are to be released. So everybody is using this business that it has thrown me out of it. So I have to log in. So I will open a new tab and log in again into the system. And then we will see whether that information was uploaded or not. I will enter the capture. Then I will log in. Oh, zero is not there. Taxpayer 4. See, I was entering the wrong number, so system did not allow me to proceed. So we should be very careful in logging in. We should very carefully create our username and password. I will quickly go through the return dashboard and see what has happened over there, whether the system has populated or not, the details which I have fetched. You remember, we have reduced it from 50 crores to 5 lakhs. And then we are viewing now whether it has come 5 lakhs or not. I have further reduced my central tax liability. And see, it has reduced. The value is coming as 10 lakhs, 10,000. So it has been actually done. What happens in HSN summary? We will quickly see over here. So HSN wise summary has to be given over here. If you see the entry at column number 2 and column number 3, a uniqueness comes code and the description of the system will not allow. I can click button and I will just try and edit it. But I will do that. I will change the code to something. Supposing I do it like this, then save the item. So it has immediately been saved. And I can add details also by clicking on add details. So here I have to fill my HSN details, descriptions, UQC code. I have to select from the drop down, total quantity, taxable value, etc. And I can add it. So I can cancel it and I can come back over here and I will save it. So details are saved. No change. If you see, data has been added, done. A message comes to me that data has been added and slowly fades away also. I will click on back button. So that's what has to be filled in. We will see slowly table number 10B. So this is adjustment of advance amount paid earlier for reverse charge tax supply. So if any advance amount has been paid earlier and I want to adjust it state-wise, then it will come over here. Then I can, by blue button, I can edit the details already there. And by red button, I can delete it. So for show purpose, I will just simply delete it. It gives me a warning. I will go ahead with the warning and I have deleted it. So if you see done, data is deleted. And I can refresh the button also if needed. But no information is coming right now because no information is to be added. Now, if I select place of supply, supposing I select Kerala, then automatically it says that interstate supplies. I have to say key gross advance, which I want to adjust, then automatically integrated taxes calculated. I will have to enter my cess amount. I do that. Then I save it. If I don't save it, it will not come. See, the addition has come up. It is appearing over here. I have added integrated tax of 480 and cess of rupees 30. Then I go back. While going back, if you see the details, the tiles will be uploaded over here. And then the amount is coming 418 rupees, which is the sum of all those amount which is coming over here. So that's the details has been uploaded. Then 10A is the advance amount paid for reverse charge supplies. So if there is any amount of the advance, then I can add over here. The tables come in a similar manner. I can click on the details also directly, and that Arunachal Pradesh details comes up. I can make an edit to it and save it. Or I can also do it by clicking on blue button, as we have seen. And we can also do it by using add details button. But it has to be given rate wise, as we have seen, and state wise is to be given. Then we will see the next tile. So the next tile is supplies from composition taxable person. If you see again, the information is not coming. If I take my cursor over here, then it is coming as red because edit button has not been enabled. So what I will do is that I will click on edit and then this button gets enabled. So much to annoyance of my team going to drastically reduce and I'm going to save it. So when my friend will open up later on, he will, I don't know what he will do because he is testing on it and I'm using that software and making changes. Let's hope he is not angry with me. So let's see the details. Yes, so details have been reduced to much reduced. It was more than 50 lakh of rupees. Then the details have changed. One thing I want to show over here is that there cannot be any, after edit, there cannot be an interstate supplies from composition dealer. So this is coming as null field. I cannot make any entries over here. Interstate supplies could come from in composition dealer. So this field is enabled. Rest of the supplies like exam, nil rated supply, non-GST supply could be interstate or could be intrastate. So all this is enabled over. That's about GSTR2 other details. If you see, the whole section is divided into GSTR2 invoice details. This is where the invoice level details has to be given. So that's 3, 4A, 5, 4C, 6C, 4B and 6C. And rest of the items as even broad level details has to be given. So that is GSTR2 other details. Now we will see some of the supplies. We will see import of inputs, capital goods, etc. Because I've already exceeded 50 minutes of my time. So I'm exceeding it further. I will take 5 more minutes to close it down and I will try to answer few question. I will attempt making answers to few questions. So kindly bear with me. And thank you very much for your cooperation. I will just refresh button to see if any details have come up. So again, the blue button is there to edit it. Red button is to delete it. I will need not delete any bill of entry. I can click on the bill of entry and can go directly in. I have to enter the port code. I have to enter the bill of entry number. And taxable value is what, amount of tax is what, whether eligibility of ITC is not there. I can select imports, capital goods, ineligible ITC. Then accordingly, supposing I select input, if you see, I can now enter the amount of ITC which is available over here. Now what I will do is that I will enter 200 rupees and let's see whether system accepts it or not. Availability is 242 rupees only. So this is the amount of tax and this is the amount of ITC available. So I'm just testing the system, it will allow me or not. I click on save. Now what message has come? It is not saying. It is giving me a message, amount of ITC available shall not exceed the amount of tax. So what I'm going to do is that I will just make it 50 paise and see, let's see it allows me or not. So if we see, I have entered 50 paisa, which is less than 66 rupees, and I will enter here 30 rupees. So that message has gone, and now I will try to save it. So it is showing, and then it's showing done, bill of entry is added. So I can add bill of entry also. So I have to enter the port code, bill of entry number, bill of entry date. I have to enter the bill of entry value to be added and I have to click on whether the key to enter. So that I have to be careful, that is to be entered, and similarly taxable value and other amount has to be entered over here. I will not. So if you see, the details have come up, the details have slightly changed. Then I will just show over here there are business to be invoices. I have clicked on. So supplier details, I will want things over here. One thing is, I am not able to take any action. It is not allowing me to select anything. Why it is not allowing me to select anything is that because the GSTR1 has not been filed by my supplier. So my supplier has not uploaded his GSTR1. That's why I cannot select it. And I cannot take any action over here. So as soon as he files his GSTR1, I can take any action. So that's why this is not coming populated. Now there is no information. So this tile shows me the information of the invoices uploaded by this supplier. And if any invoices of this supplier I have uploaded, it will be shown over here. So what is happening is that the invoices uploaded, which has been uploaded by my supplier, I cannot take any action because my supplier has not uploaded it. But since my supplier has forgotten to upload some of the invoices, like two of the invoices over here, so I have uploaded these two invoices. So these details are available to me. So these are the four invoices uploaded by my supplier. These are the two invoices uploaded by me. So total six invoices are available for me. I can click on add missing invoice details and add any further invoice particular to this supplier. I'm not going to do any such thing, and because it's time to close now. So one of the questions which is asked is that GSTR2 is compulsory for whom? As we have seen, the persons who are liable to file GSTR1 has to file GSTR2, and the persons who are not liable to file it is composition dealer, then ISD, TCS, TDS, and non-resident access. Then is there any option to download GSTR2? As we have seen, there is an option to download GSTR2. Then is there any offline utility tool for GSTR2? Yes, it is being developed, and can it be, and it will be available soon for the taxpayer for it. With that, I will close this session now. I hope this was useful. Thank you very much for joining, and we will come back after some time for Hindi version of GSTR2 returns next week, and we can do it in some other languages also. And at 4 o'clock, we are going to have a TRAN1 webinar session. You can join that also. Over to you, Prabhakar. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rajiv sir. And it was a very interactive and a thrilling session. So just to close, before we close the session, on the user's demand, we would like to show you how we can find out the webinar presentations and videos on our KMS portal. I'm just going to share my screen. So to find out the presentations and webinars used in our past webinars and this webinar, what we need to do is we need to go to any of our browsers and type in kms.negd.in. It loads up the knowledge management system of NGD. There is a down arrow. Click on it. Once you have clicked on the down arrow, you reach the search knowledge page. On the search knowledge page, you have to type GST search. You will get all the presentations in PDF format and the videos of the webinar in the video format on this page. So the presentation which Rajiv sir referred to just now is already available here. Once you see this presentation, you can. There are two options available for your disposal. This one of them is the download one. You can always download the presentation for your future reference, or you can print it also. We thank our YouTube participants also, and you can always visit the GSTN YouTube channel also for further information and such informative videos. Before we sign off, we would be coming back today again at 4 p.m. with a new topic, that would be filing of GST Trans 1. This would be taken up by one of our good speakers, experienced speakers, which is Mr. Sashi Bhushan Singh. So thanks again once to all of you, to our webinar participants and our YouTube participants, and signing off for now. Thank you.